Hello and welcome back to another video. My name is Mike Davies, and today the drought is finally over because I'll be covering what's new in GIMP 2.10.24. Before I get into that, don't forget to check out my website at daviesmediadesign.com. As always, I have tons of GIMP, Inkscape, and Darktable tutorials on here. You can get more by becoming a DMD Premium member. And I have tons of free software help articles, so definitely check that out. You can enroll in my GIMP 2.10 masterclass from beginner to pro photo editing on Udemy. And as I mentioned, you can get more with a premium membership to Davies Media Design, and I'll include a link to this as well as all the relevant links from this tutorial in the description of the video. All right, so GIMP has ended what was officially the longest drought between stable release versions since GIMP 2.10 was initially released. Now, there were a couple of development versions that were released in between GIMP 2.10.22 and GIMP 2.10.24. Also, the GIMP 2.10.22 Mac installer came out during this drought, but of course, that's not a new release version. So at the time of this video, 175 days have passed between the last version and now this new GIMP 2.10.24. That being said, let's get into what is found in this new version, and I'm not gonna lie, it's a little bit on the disappointing side, the reason being there's not a ton of brand new features, filters, etc. A lot of what has come out with this new version is gonna be bug fixes, as well as shoring up the core code of GIMP so that I can get ready for the GIMP 3.0 overhaul. So the first new feature I'll highlight in this new release version is that your tools will now snap to grids, guides, and your active path outside of the canvas area. So in previous versions of GIMP, if the guide went outside the canvas area, for example, your tool would not snap to that guide. It would just basically pass over it like it wasn't there. However, if your tool was inside of the canvas area, then it would snap to the guide, the grid, or the active path. So GIMP has sort of fixed that now that it allows for off-canvas features. So you'll remember if you go to View, Show all, it'll now show areas outside your canvas and those pixels won't get deleted automatically. They will display here. And you don't need this on necessarily, by the way, for this feature to work, but they've also extended snapping to the guides here or the grid or your active path. So I've just quickly drawn some guides here, and now let me come over and grab a random tool like the paintbrush tool and go to View. And make sure snap to guides is checked as well as snap to active path. If you want to test this out with the grid, you can also do snap to grid, but I'll keep that turned off. So now when I hold control and zoom in, when I hover my mouse over this path, of course it snaps to the path there. But if I hold control, scroll out with my mouse wheel, hold control, zoom in. Now when I am outside of the canvas area, it will also snap to that guide. So that just makes it easier to draw along guides as well as draw along a path. So let's say you drew a path diagonally to act like a diagonal guide, since GIMP does not support diagonal guides. And by the way, I do have an entire tutorial on how to do that. But now this just makes it easier to draw along those guides or to place objects along those guides using snapping. So let me just grab the move tool and I'm just gonna hover over the middle of these two guides and drag it off the canvas. The next new feature is a GEGL operation known as negative darkroom. So this isn't necessarily a filter that's going to be displayed in the main area with all the other filters. However, it is a generic GEGL operation, which means you can access it by going to Tools, GEGL operation, and using this drop down here, we can come over to negative darkroom. And this isn't gonna look right for now because this is not what this is intended for. So what this feature is for is people who take photos with a traditional film camera, and then they take the film negative that's taken from that camera and they scan it into their computer. And once it's scanned into their computer, they wanna blow up the size of that negative as well as convert that to a color photo. So it's a pretty niche use case, as I don't really know of many people who do that. I know there's some businesses that rely on converting film negatives to digital photos. So I could see it being used for that, but that is a new feature here in GIMP 2.10.24. The next new feature found in this new version of GIMP is that GIMP can now export GeoTIFF metadata And this is for people who enhance historic maps. So again, this is a pretty obscure use case, but the reason this is important is that it was done by somebody referred to as a passing contributor. So this is somebody who does not regularly contribute to GIMP. They just sort of hopped on the project for a couple of months, implemented this new feature that somebody requested, and then hopped back off GIMP. So it just sort of highlights the fact that GIMP is made by random people coming and going and helping to implement new features. And it doesn't really matter how long you spend on this program. As long as you have the capability, you jump in, you do whatever it is you need to do, and then you go about your business, it still does help GIMP tremendously. The other important lesson here is that this feature was actually implemented first inside of GIMP 2.99.4. That is a development version for GIMP 3.0. So in other words, just because the GIMP team announces a new feature is coming out in GIMP 3.0, it doesn't mean that we can't see that new feature earlier, so we don't necessarily have to wait for GIMP 3.0 to get a cool new feature. Moving on, there have been many improvements made to various file formats found in GIMP. The most important, in my opinion, is that raw file support has been improved for GIMP. This does not mean that GIMP can now open raw files. It still cannot do that. It requires Darktable or raw therapy to do that. However, this sort of secures the future of raw files for GIMP because the updated support means that this is basically guaranteed to work in future versions of Darktable, specifically Darktable 3.6, which has not come out yet. However, the GIMP team says that this new update ensures that the raw file support will continue through Darktable 3.6 at the very least. Some additional improvements made to file formats in GIMP include TIFF files, which now receive additional multi-page TIFF support, JPEGs, which now give the user an error anytime the metadata was not correctly written on export of that JPEG file, and finally a prompt for importing multi-page PDFs that asks the user if they want to reverse the order of the multi-page PDF. This feature was available for when you were exporting multi-page PDFs outside of GIMP, but now it's going to be available when you are importing documents into GIMP. As per usual, BABL and GEGL both received updates for this newest release version, and most notably, GEGL received an update to the paint select operation. This is designed to help pave the way for the brand new paint select tool that's coming to GIMP 3.0, if not sooner. Although I don't think it's going to come sooner than GIMP 3.0. It has already been released in GIMP 2.99.4 for testing. However, in my tests, it really was not tenable inside of Windows versions. It basically just crashed GIMP every time you try to use it. So this new update to GEGL should help the performance of the paint select tool and make its introduction into GIMP 3.0 a reality. One last thing before I get into a sort of epilogue here for this video is that the Mac version has not come out yet, although it is expected to come out in the next few days. They only have one Mac developer who is working on compiling the download package. So it's basically whenever that person has time to complete the download package and get it up on the GIMP servers. So that leads me to the final point of this video, which is that it took about 175 days to get this GIMP release out. And that just begs the question, what was the GIMP development team doing all this time? Now, I'm not saying that the GIMP team hasn't done anything. I mean, these features are great. It's great to see some updates made to the GIMP program. Great to see the core is strengthened a little bit and that the program perhaps is made more stable. But really, when 175 days or almost 6 months go by, you would anticipate really there being some robust changes, some brand new filters, some new user-oriented features. There are plenty of things people are waiting for to come to GIMP that are available in other programs. So really got to worry about the pace at which these new release versions are coming out and the lack of new features found in these release versions. One promising note that was found at the end of the press release for this latest release version of GIMP is that the GIMP team thinks development on GIMP 3.0 is very strong, so there does appear to be a lot of activity around GIMP 3.0. And they did mention that there's not really going to be any flashy new features found between GIMP 2.10.x release versions and GIMP 3.0, since a lot of the focus is going towards GIMP 3.0. Still, if these GIMP 2.10.x versions are going to be considered bridge versions, it would be nice to see more progress coming out of these versions. I know that's easier said than done since I'm not a developer, but I think a couple of factors will help speed up the progress of GIMP. Number one, of course, is funding GIMP. So if you guys have any sort of means to fund GIMP, I'll include links to where you can help fund GIMP, basically help support the developers who make GIMP possible. And the second thing I think is going to be ending the pandemic. And for those of you who think that's a pretty poor excuse for low productivity, just remember that the pandemic has affected some people more than others. So you might have had some developers that lost their jobs and now they have to spend all their free time they used to spend working on GIMP finding a job, or maybe their job is all done at home now since a lot of people are working from home. So you have to do your main job at home and then your side job at home. And that can become really tedious and kill your productivity. So hopefully once everything opens back up, people will feel more productive. They'll be able to go out, let off some steam, come back, work on GIMP. Maybe more people, contributors, will flock to the project, and hopefully we'll see more progress made on GIMP while also getting GIMP 3.0 released. All right, so that's it for this tutorial. Hopefully you liked it. If you did, don't forget to subscribe to this channel and click the bell icon to be notified each time I have a brand new tutorial. You can check out any of the links to my resources in the description of the video, but thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.